Welcome. In this lecture, we will be discussing operational fundamentals of linear algebra. In particular, we will be talking about range and null space, their dimensions, rank and nullity respectively, basis for representing vectors in a space, and change of basis, and an introduction to the technique of elementary transformations. To start with, consider a mapping A from Rn to Rm. The matrix A will be of m by n size, which will be something like this. It will have m rows and n columns, and therefore it will multiply a vector of size n and give a vector of size m. And therefore, we say that the mapping is from Rn to Rm. X is in Rn and y is in Rm, m dimensional vector. We observe the same two observe make the we make the same observations as we made in the last lecture, that every x in Rn when multiplied like this will certainly result into a y. That is, every x in Rn has an image y in Rm, but on the other hand, every y in Rm does not have to have a pre image x to which multiplying with a we will get y. Such is not necessary. Now, then we can talk of those vectors in Rm for which there is some x, and the set of all these vectors is called the range space or the range. So, we find that the range space is a subset, also a subspace of the codomain containing images of all x. That means, Rm could be a larger set, and then we can single out all those members in Rm which come as a result of multiplying the matrix A to some vectors to all the vectors in the domain which is Rn. And this subset of the codomain is called the range, that is the range of the linear transformation. In the codomain there may be larger space available, but the entire space available in the codomain is not used by the linear transformation A. It only a subset of it, which is the range of A, is being utilized for the purpose of mapping. The second observation that we made is that the mapping from x to y, in order to be a mapping, must be unique. That is, for a given x, we have a unique y. That is obvious, because in this matrix multiplication, the result is always unique. But the reverse does not have to be true. That is, for a given y, it is not necessary that the x should be unique and no other x should map to y. That is not necessary. So, the second observation says that the image of x in Rn to Rm is unique, but the pre image of y does not have to be. That means, for the same y in the codomain or in the range for that matter, there could be several x which map to the same y. Why several? There could be infinite vectors in Rn which map to the same vector in Rm. Now, if such is the scenario with the matrix A, that it maps infinite vectors from the domain to the same vector in the range, then that will in particular be true for the 0 vector in Rm as well. And then we find another definition from this observation, and that is the definition of null space. Those vectors in the domain in Rn which map to the 0 vector in the codomain or in the range, they form a subset of the domain, and that subset is called the null space. So, we find that the null space is a subset or subspace of the domain which contains all free images of only 0. Pictorially or schematically, we can see it like this. That is, this entire space is the domain R n, this entire space is the codomain R m. Now, the entire R n domain must get mapped, but then it may get mapped to a subspace of the codomain. That subspace is the range space. On the other side, in the domain there is a subspace here hashed differently, which all gets mapped to the 0 vector in the codomain. This subspace here is called the null space, that is, it does not have any information content in it, all that goes to 0. Now, we introduce two more terms, two more definitions, that is rank and nullity. Before doing that, we need to ask what is the dimension of a vector space. Note that here we are talking about 4 vector spaces: the domain, codomain, the subspace of the domain which is a null space which is also a vector space, and the subspace of the codomain, that is the range space, which is also a vector space. So, we are talking about all these 4 vector spaces. So, we ask what is the dimension of domain, and that is n. What is the dimension of the codomain, that is m. Then, to introduce rank and nullity, we ask another question which we should have asked by now, and that is, what is the dimension of a vector space? What is the dimension of a vector space? So, for that we need to talk about linear independence of vectors, linear dependence and linear independence. In a vector space, suppose we take several vectors x 1, x 2, x 3 up to x r, r vectors we have taken. Now, when do we call these vectors as linearly dependent or linearly independent? So, the simple straightforward idea of linear dependence and independence is that if x, a vector x, can be expressed as a linear combination of several vectors like this, then in such a situation we say x is linearly dependent on x 1 and x 2, which means that x can be formed by a linear combination of x 1 and x 2. In other words, we can say x 1, x 2 and x are linearly dependent together. So, these 3 then will form a linearly dependent set. So, there is a linear dependence among these vectors. When we talk about the linear dependence of several vectors together, then typically in the most general sense we say it in this manner, that is, if k 1 x 1 plus k 2 x 2 up to k r x r, if the whole sum being 0 necessarily implies that all these contributions are independently 0, that will mean that these vectors are linearly independent, in the sense that from one place on earth, if you need to go to another place on the earth, on the surface, then you think of two directions: how much east west I have to go and how much north south I have to go. Now, this east west and north south, they are two independent directions. Then you say that wherever I need to go, I can go by moving a little east west or a little north south. Then basically you will be talking about a little east west plus a little north south, and this together gives you a movement on earth, and that movement is then linearly dependent on these two individual movements, east west movement, north south movement. Now, these 3 directions that you have got, the east west direction, north south direction and the direction in which you actually traveled, these 3 are linearly dependent. Now, this statement that these vectors are linearly dependent if the whole sum equal to 0 necessarily implies this entire set of k1, k2, k3 being totally 0. That means that a moment on ground is 0, it is no movement if its east west component is 0 as well as its north south component is 0. That shows that these are linearly dependent vectors. So, that means any change from 0 in any of these will not be compensated by any suitable change in any other. That means the moment you change any of these coefficients, this sum will turn out to be non-zero. No other compensation from any other component will be possible. So, in the true sense, these vectors x1, x2, x3, etcetera are independent of each other. There is any change in one cannot be compensated by any suitable change in others. Now, we say that if in a vector space we are hunting for vectors which are linearly independent among themselves. So, we find one vector. The moment we find one vector in that vector space, many other vectors in the vector space become linearly dependent on it. We hunt for another which is linearly independent of it. So, we get two such vectors. Like this, as we go on looking for vectors which are linearly independent of the vectors which are already collected, finally, we might reach a situation where the process ends, where no more vectors are found which are linearly independent of the vectors which are already collected. Now, we see how many vectors we have already collected which are linearly independent among themselves. That number is the dimension of this vector space. The Earth's surface has a dimension 2, because after you exhaust east west direction and north south direction, no more direction is necessary. With these two directions, movements in these two directions, you can reach any place on the earth. In this three dimensional world in which we live, why we say three dimensional world? Because here there are three linearly independent directions. You go east west and you go north south and you go up down. With these three independent movements, you can reach any point in this physical space. That is why physical space is three dimensional. With this idea of the dimension of a vector space to be the number of linearly independent vectors contained in it, we define two more terms. As we have already discussed, range of A is the set of all images of all x's in the domain. Null space of A is the set of all those x's in the domain which map to 0 in the range. Now, the dimension of the range space is called the rank. Similarly, dimension of the null space is called the nullity. These definitions are extremely important and should be remembered in all the discussion that we conduct subsequently. Now, to describe vectors in a vector space, we talk of basis. That is, in terms of which vectors we can describe all the vectors in a vector space. In this manner, we want a handful of vectors x1, x2, etcetera, as linear combinations of which we would like to represent all vectors in that vector space. And this is the idea behind looking for a basis. These members x1, x2, etcetera will be called the basis members. To define a basis, we ask this question. Given a vector v in the vector space, question is, can we describe it in this manner as a linear combination of r chosen vectors, v1, v2, v3 up to vr, r chosen vectors. Can we do this? As if we have chosen r vectors to form the basis to describe all other vectors in that vector space, and then in that vector space a candidate vector v appears, and we are trying to express this vector v as a linear combination of the chosen vectors. Is it possible or not? Well, this can be written in shorthand in this manner, because these vectors collected as column vectors. And multiplied with these k's, it actually gives us k1 v1 plus k2 v2 plus k3 v3, and so on up to k r v r, the way it has been shown here. And that is why this matrix, this large matrix, we can call as capital V and this vector as k. Now, the question is that with v1 v2 v3 v4 up to v r known, we essentially know this matrix, and the vector v that has been given to us, we know this, and we are interested in finding out suitable k1 k2 up to k r such that this turns out to be right, that is the new vector v gets represented as a linear combination of the vectors which are there in our collection. Now, the question has been raised, and the answer to this question is that it is not necessarily always possible. Now, if it is not possible always, then we say that then these vectors, what these vectors are doing? These vectors among themselves in this kind of a linear combination, in this kind of a linear combination, will generate a subspace in the vector space. That subspace will have lesser dimension than the entire vector space. And that subspace sometimes we denote as the span of these vectors. So, this is the span of these vectors, and we say that the subspace described or generated by these vectors is called the span of these vectors, denoted by these angle brackets. And in other words, we say that these vectors span this particular subspace. So, span is used either as a verb or as a noun. Then, when we look for the complete basis of a vector space, we define it in this manner. A basis of a vector space is composed of an ordered minimal set of vectors spanning the entire space. That means that after we collect so many members v1 v2 v3 v4, etcetera, such that all vectors in the vector space can be expressed in this manner, when finally, the answer to this question turns out to be yes after collecting enough, then we say that can we do with less number of vectors in this collection. If we can, then whichever vectors are not required, we throw them out. That is the meaning of the word minimal here, and then we need an ordering among them. This is our first basis member, this is our second basis member, this is our third basis member, and so on. What remains gives us the basis of a vector space. For example, when we want to describe the points or vectors in this world in which we live, we say we take one direction, that is north. Many vectors, many movements in this world can be represented by this, all northward movements to be precise. Then we need one more direction, then we say okay, east. Note that west is same as east, just the negative sign. Then we say that all places on this plane consisting of north and east directions are covered, including here in the other quadrants. Then we say that still we remain on the ground only. What we need to do is to go up also. Then suppose we try this direction, northeast, and it does not help. It does not help us to go upward. By going northeast, we do not go upward. So, then by going northeast, to which are the directions in which we can go? We find that by going northeast, we go a little east and a little north. That means this direction of northeast is actually linearly dependent on east and north. So, it is not needed, and we will look for a minimal set. So, this is not needed. So, the direction of northeast is not needed. So, which is the direction that is needed? Any direction which has an upward or downward component will help. So, we take a direction which is upward or downward. It can be perpendicular to this plane, but it need not be. Okay. So, let us call it up, away from the blackboard as I draw it. Now, we have got three directions, okay, east, north and up. And with these three directions, we have formed a triad like this. So, with these three directions at our disposal, we will be able to represent any other direction, any other movement. Okay. So, there is no need of going for a fourth, and we keep only three. You noticed that three were barely minimum which were needed, and more than three we will not keep. Okay. So, why three were barely needed? Because the dimension of this space which we are trying to describe is 3, and therefore, we also say that the basis for an n dimensional space will have exactly n members, all linearly independent. Exactly n members to keep the set minimal, and all linearly independent to be able to describe all vectors in the vector space. Finally, we need to order them. We have to say east is our first coordinate, north is our second coordinate, and up is our third coordinate. As we do this, our job for forming the basis is complete, because after doing this, now when we say that the coordinate of a particular point in the atmosphere happens to be alpha, beta, gamma, then the description of this is completely known. We have to go alpha distance in the east direction, then beta distance in the north direction, and gamma distance in the upward direction. So, only when the ordering is also prescribed, then the statement of the basis gets completed. Sometimes we talk of a particular kind of basis which is called orthogonal basis, in which these vectors are perpendicular to each other. In this particular situation, we have actually taken the example of a basis which happens to be orthogonal, because in the directions, between the directions east and north, there is a right angle, and between the direction of east and up also there is a right angle, and so on. Okay. So, mathematically we can say Vj transpose Vk is equal to 0 when this holds for all j and k which are not equal, that is V1 transpose V2, V1 transpose V3, V2 transpose V3, when all these three are 0. That means, when this angle and this angle all are right angles like this, then we say that this basis is orthogonal, right angled. Similarly, we take another special case in which all three have unit vectors of the same size. That is, if we consider 1 kilometer in the east and 1 kilometer in the north and 1 kilometer in the upward direction as of the same size in the description, then we will say that this is orthonormal basis, orthonormal, right sized, not only right angled, but also of right size. In that case, we say that this Vj transpose Vk is not just 0 for j and k different, but it is 1 for j and k same. You might note that members of an orthonormal basis, they will have several unit vectors all perpendicular to one another. Okay. So, these members, these vectors together written like this will form a matrix which is orthogonal matrix. And of course, you already know that these are the properties of an orthogonal matrix. Its inverse is the same as transpose, or you can say V transpose is identity. This is the test for a matrix being orthogonal. In particular, its determinant also is known. It will be either plus 1 or minus 1. Sometimes we describe vectors without mentioning the basis, the way till now we have been doing, by just writing x1, x2, x3, x4 in a column. What we are doing? What basis we are using then? Then we are actually, without mentioning, using a particular basis which comes naturally to us. and that is called the natural basis. Natural basis members are just this 1 0 0 0 0, then 0 1 0 0 0, then 0 0 1 0 0 0, and so on. So, these are the natural basis members and they are quite often represented with these symbols E1, E2, E3, E4 up to E n. This n shows the dimension of that vector space. Now, after describing the vectors of a vector space for quite some time in this basis, the natural basis, or say some other basis, we want to change the basis. That is, we do not want, suppose we do not want these directions and we do not want these lengths also. We want to describe the vectors in this three dimensional world in terms of 5 kilometer distance in this direction, which is a little north of east, then 3 kilometer movement in this direction, which is a little east of north, and the third direction is not directly upward, but a little upward, inclined like this. In particular, we could do that. And for example, in this, we say we will take a very small unit. Okay, this is just 200 meters. We can do it. We can describe the three-dimensional world in terms of three coordinates, which are the locations in which are the distances along this direction, along this direction, and along this direction, with the units being different. That kind of a thing is possible, and sometimes it makes sense to do that. For example, if you want to prescribe locations on a road, how will you do it? Suppose this is the road and you want to describe locations, points on this road, then it will not help to describe the distances along north and east. Or for this road, if you want to specify points on this road, it will not be a great idea to describe in this manner, that is, this much is movement in north east and this much is the movement in north. That will not be a good idea. Besides, using the same unit on both sides also will not be a good idea, because in that case the descriptions will be always quite lopsided. The correct description would be movement along this direction, which is in kilometers, and movement along this direction, which is in meters. Because otherwise, if you choose the same unit, say kilometers, then for the direction along the road, you will be talking about 10 kilometers, 100 kilometers, and so on. And for this, you will end up telling 0.3 kilometers, 0.15 kilometers, and so on, which will not be very nice. On the other hand, if you choose meter, then also you will have fine description for the breadth of the road, but not for the length of the road. So, therefore, it is quite often possible to require, to need the change of basis. Let us take an example. Suppose you have a table which is not rectangular, but which is of this shape. Okay. And in this rectangle, in this table, I think it is parallelogram. Parallelogram shape, and on this table, on the surface of the table, there are marks like this. And the sizes of these small parallelograms are 3 centimeter in this direction, 2 centimeter in this direction. So, 3, 2, 3, 2, like this, right. So, this is suppose the top of the table in which this kind of marks are made. It is a design. Now, suppose this particular table is kept and you want to know the distances along this and along this edge of the table, which will take you here. Okay. Distances not in centimeters, but in terms of the steps. How many steps in this direction and how many steps in this direction will take me here. So, for that, suppose our original frame of reference in terms of north, east or whatever in the rectangular Cartesian frame, suppose that Cartesian frame happens to be this. Let us call it x 1 and x 2. Now, when we say we want to know how many steps along this edge and how many steps parallel to this edge will take us here, we are essentially asking for the coordinates of this point in the table system, and table system has its axis like this and like this, right. So, then first thing we need to know, what is the description of the units of the table system in the original x 1 x 2 system. So, for that we take this unit and say how much it is from here to here. So, this point in the original system, suppose it is described by a vector c 1, which is this much along x 1, this much along x 2, like this. Similarly, this unit, which is 2 centimeters in this case, okay, we are want to find out its this vector's description in the original x 1 x 2 system and call it c 2. Now, we have this movement as a vector c 1, this movement as another vector c 2, and now we want to find out how many c 1 movements and how many c 2 movements will take us here, right. So, then we say how many c 1 movements plus how many c 2 movement will take us here, x 1 x 2. Now, this left side we can write like this, these are column vectors, this vector c 1 and this vector c 2, those basis members for the table system, those basis members for the table system are sitting here into t 1 t 2 as a column vector. Note that this matrix vector multiplication will give us t 1 c 1 plus t 2 c 2, what is here, right. So, or we can concisely write it as the square matrix C into this vector t is equal to the actual location of this in the x 1 x 2 frame, that is x. This gives us an equation relating the number of steps along the edges of the table t 1 t 2 to the location of this point, which we know in the old x 1 x 2 system. And if we want to find out t, then we need to invert the matrix C and get it like this, right. So, that will tell us how many steps along this we go here and here to find this point. So, this tells us the conversion from the old coordinates to the new coordinates, and this tells us the conversion from the new coordinates to the old coordinates. As we formalize this methodology, we say that suppose x represents a vector or point in R n in some basis. Now, if we change to a new basis consisting of these as the basis members, then how does the representation of the vector change? we say that if with x 1 bar, x 2 bar, x 3 bar movements along c 1, c 2, c 3 basis members, we can achieve the complete vector x, then we will representing, we will be representing x as a linear combination of these individual components along c 1, c 2, c 3, etcetera. This entire sum can be shown in this manner. Note that matrix vector multiplication will give us x 1 bar c 1 plus x 2 bar c 2 and so on, right. Now, these column vectors sitting here will have n column vectors each of size n, and that is a square matrix. We can write it in this manner with c, c 1, c 2, c 3, etcetera up to c n this manner, then we will have x is equal to c into x bar vector, and that gives us the conversion system from the new coordinates to the old coordinates. By inverting this matrix C, we get the transformation from the old coordinates to the new coordinates, and make note that this inversion will always be possible, that is, this matrix is invertible, because we already know that to form a basis c 1, c 2, c 3, c 4 up to c n, and that gives us a methodology for conversion from the new system to the old system. And when we want the reverse, that is from the old to the new, when we want the conversion, we have to invert this matrix C, and we get the formula as x bar is equal to C inverse x, as we found in this case. Now, in a special case, we have C matrix C as orthogonal. That means, in that case, the basis members will be all unit vectors and mutually orthogonal, and that means it will be an orthonormal basis. And in that case, this type of a basis change we call as orthogonal coordinate transformation. Now, we have seen that how the change of basis affects the representation of vectors. The vector x in the old system gets represented as vector x bar, and the relationship between the old description and the new description is given by this matrix consisting of the basis members as its columns. Now, we say that how does such a change of basis will affect the description of a linear transformation? How does this basis change affect the representation of a linear transformation? Consider this mapping A from R n to R m in this manner. A multiplying with x produces y. So, that gives the description of a linear transformation. Now, we change the basis of the domain through a matrix P. That means, P will be an n by n matrix with its columns as the new basis members for the domain. Similarly, Q will be another square matrix of m by m size, in which the columns will be the basis vectors for the codomain, that is for y. In such a situation, based on the discussion that we just now had, the new vector x bar in the domain and the old vector x in the domain will be related like this through the matrix P. Similarly, the new and old vectors in the codomain, corresponding vectors in the codomain, will be y bar and y, representing the same point geometrically, and they will be related through this matrix Q, which contains the basis members for the codomain. Now, originally the transformation, the mapping was represented with matrix A between x and y. Now, the same thing we write here, A x equal to y, and as we do that, A x equal to y. Now, for x, we use this and say x is nothing but p inverse p x bar. X is nothing but p x bar. P x bar. And what is y? Y we get from here. Y is q y bar. Q y bar. Now, remember what we wanted to find out? We wanted to find out the matrix representation of the same linear transformation in the new basis as a result of the basis change. That is, we wanted to find out the matrix representation of the linear transformation which will map x bar to y bar. That means, we wanted something such that something into x bar gives us y bar. To get that, we can pre multiply with q inverse and get that as q inverse a p x bar is equal to y bar. This matrix will now map x bar to y bar. That means, it will describe the same linear transformation as the bases in the domain and in the codomain have been changed to p and q respectively. And that formally we say that the new matrix representation of that same old linear transformation will be q inverse a p. In the special case where the mapping is from R n to R n itself, we have m is equal to n and p is equal to q. This gives us what is called a similarity transformation. This is an issue, this is a topic to which we will have ample amount of time devoted later when we discuss the matrix eigenvalue problem or the algebraic eigenvalue problem. Before that, in this lecture, we consider one more important topic which will be very crucial in our discussion of systems of linear equations, and that topic is elementary transformations. Now, suppose you have a number of linear equations among a number of unknowns. Now, we need to recognize that certain reorganizations of the equations in the system have no effect in the solutions, or for that matter on the description of the system itself, it does not have too much effect. It has the basic difference of expressing the same relationships in a different manner. For example, these three, we will find that if we interchange two equations, the first equation we write at the third location and the third equation we write in the first location, then the system does not change. And in the way of writing the equation in this manner, Ax equal to b, that will amount to the interchange of two rows of A and B. That is, if we interchange the first equation with the third equation, that will basically mean that in this matrix vector representation of the system of equations, that is equivalent to changing of two rows. This is called one of the three transformations that are called elementary row transformations. So, this is one elementary row transformation. Next, if we multiply the seventh row with 2 or 1/3, does it change the system? No, it does not. So, that is equivalent to changing the scaling of a particular equation. Okay, so, that is scaling of a row. So, if we multiply one of the equations in the system by a scalar all over on the left side as well as on the right side, then that does not change the solutions of the system of equations. So, scaling of a row is another elementary row transformation. The third one is addition of a scalar multiple of one row to another. That is, suppose earlier we had one equation and a second equation. Now, how does it change the system if in place of the second equation we consider a sum of the two equations? It will not change the solutions of the system of equation. One individual equation will be basically replaced by another equation which is equivalent to the old one in relationships with the rest of the equations. So, this gives us the third elementary row transformation, addition of a scalar multiple of a row to another. Corresponding to these three elementary row transformations, we have elementary column transformations also. Similar operations with columns equivalent to corresponding shuffling of not the equations, but of the variables. in that case interchanging of the first and second column will mean the equivalent of writing x 1 and x 2 in the reverse manner. Now, two matrices are called equivalent if you can change from one of the matrices to the other through a series of elementary transformations. So, these matrices which can be shifted from one to other through elementary transformations are called equivalent matrices. They are equivalent matrices, they are equivalent in the sense that they satisfy the requirements of equivalence relations. Now, through elementary transformations you can reduce any matrix to this normal form, in which there will be a leading block, leading square block of r by r size of identity matrix, and then everything else is 0. Any matrix you can reduce up to this form through elementary row transformations and elementary column transformations. You can note that in this, other than dimension and rank of the matrix, nothing else survives. The rank shows up here in R. So, this identity matrix is of size R by R. Now, up to this much reduction is possible, but not of great significance. It does not have enormous amount of applied use. Most of the time in applications we use only row transformations or only column transformations for desired ends. This is an important issue, that after we keep on reducing the matrix through equivalent row transformations, elementary row transformations, we cannot get rid of this R. That shows that elementary transformations do not alter the rank of a matrix. There is one very interesting way of looking at an elementary transformation. Let us do that with a small example. What we do here is that we take this matrix 3 1 2 1 0 minus 1 and apply a linear transformation, an elementary row transformation to it. And the same elementary row transformation we also apply to an identity matrix. Suppose the elementary row transformation that we decide to apply is this: add 2 times the first row to the second row. If we do that, then what we get here? First row remains unchanged, the second row gets twice the first row added to it. Get this. When you apply the same transformation, same elementary row transformation to the identity matrix, we get twice the first row gets added to the second row. We get this matrix. Now, if we have applied the elementary row transformation to the identity matrix of the appropriate size and got this, then it would also be possible to get this same matrix not through a direct application of the elementary transformation on this matrix, but by pre-multiplying this matrix here. I am reproducing it here for convenience. Now, if we multiply this matrix with this, then see 3 plus 0, 3, 1 plus 0, 1, 2 plus 0, 2, and in the next row 2 into 3 plus 1, 7, 2 plus 0, 2, then 4 minus 1, 3. So, that shows that to get this matrix, we actually had two ways available: either apply the elementary row transformation on this matrix directly, or pre-multiply this matrix with this square matrix, which was found through the application of the same elementary row transformation on an identity matrix. And this matrix in that case is called an elementary matrix. So, we get this situation: an elementary row transformation on a matrix is equivalent to a pre-multiplication with an elementary matrix, and that elementary matrix is the one which is obtained through the same row transformation on the identity matrix of appropriate size. Similarly, an elementary column transformation is equivalent to a corresponding post multiplication. These issues will be found extremely important when we try to apply elementary transformations for the solution of systems of linear equations in the next lecture. For the time being, we summarize the important points that must be noted from this lesson. The important issues are, first, the concepts of the range and null space of a linear transformation. Second, effects of change of basis on representation of vectors and representations of linear transformations from one vector space to another vector space. Third important issue from this lesson is the idea of elementary transformations as tools to modify, essentially simplify, systems of simultaneous linear equations. These concepts will be extremely useful for our subsequent lessons on the systems of linear equations. Thank you.